Okay, I guess we can start, and if people are coming by, they can just come in. So welcome to the XMPP Meetup. Nice that so many people are here and also in the stream. And we have a special guest because tonight it's not about XMPP, or later it's going to be about XMPP as well. But first we are going to talk about Briar. Sorry, technical difficulties. Thanks also to Niklas for providing us the equipment and everything for the stream. This time we are trying a hybrid event. So we are here in the XHine, but we are also at home, and we use the XMPP group chat as the base for asking questions. So feel free to discuss in the chat. In English and German, feel free to ask your questions in the chat, and you can, and we will forward them here into the room. And yeah, our first talk is by Nico Alt. Nico Alt studies physics at the Technical University in Darmstadt, and he is one of the developers of Briar. As far as I know, the first desktop Briar development, the developer. So he is building a client for Briar on GTK first, but I guess we will learn much more about this. So thanks a lot for being here, Nico. Yeah. It's a pleasure, and we are looking to dive deep into Briar.
Thanks a lot. Okay, so hello, and welcome to my talk, Diving Deep into Briar, where I want to take a closer look at its internals. And
like Felix said, my name is Nico Alt. I joined the Briar project some 2 years ago, when I first started with playing around with desktop prototypes. But I'm also interested in the core code of Briar, and today I want to share with you what I learned in the last 2 years about it. So what is Briar? Briar is a messaging app designed for activists, journalists, and anyone else who needs a safe, easy, and robust way to communicate. This is the first quote on the website. And Briar does this by using a peer-to-peer approach. So there are no servers involved and that you are dependent on, but all the messages can go directly from device to device. And this allows Briar to do stuff like if the internet is down, Briar synchronizes messages, or can synchronize messages, via Bluetooth or Wi-Fi, so that your messages still reach your contacts. But if the internet is available, Briar uses the Tor network to send your messages to your contacts, but also to protect the users and to protect their relationships from surveillance. And on this last part of the sentence, I want to put the emphasis here, protecting relationships, because one major goal of Briar is to also protect metadata. You will see a lot of results that come from this. And only to directly clarify it, in the Briar terminology, the Tor network, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth are called transports. And in this talk, I will go a little bit more deeper into Briar, but I can also recommend to you the talk by my colleague Thorsten Krote, who already talked about Briar at the 34th Chaos Communication Congress, which you can watch on media.ccc.de. And there's a more general talk that also talks about why we need Briar and this metadata protection. Yeah, so here is the first feature that you might expect from a messenger. You can send messages to one contact in private chats. And due to Briar's metadata protection, those messages are always only sent directly to your contact. So if you are, for example, a peer group of 3 people and you want to send a message to Bob, you won't send that message to the third party so that they might relay it later on, but you always only directly send messages to Bob. so that the third person don't know that you're communicating with Bob and when you're communicating and all that stuff. I will talk later on why this is cool but also difficult in certain situations. But let's go on to group chats for now. So these are the group chats. One thing you directly notice maybe is that they are threaded. So there's no linear chat history, but you can, like on Reddit, reply to a message and then it gets indented visually. And this is important because in peer-to-peer networks, especially with the next feature, the forums that we'll talk about, it might happen that there are two subnets communicating with each other in the forum or in the group, and then one moment they join back together, and then what are you doing with the linear chat history? So Briar tries to make this better by using threaded communication so that it's more clear like what relates to each other. And with private groups, the thing is that only the group creator can invite people, and all the messages are relayed via this group creator, so that the identities of the members are protected, so that nobody knows the other identities. But we also have forums that look almost identically visually, but here, anybody can share a forum with their contacts. And then, for example, if you share a forum with your contacts, then you send all the messages to that forum to all the contacts you shared it with. But the, if you receive a forum invitation and join that forum, you only communicate with the contact that invited you. So this is a common misunderstanding of Briar, that it's a mesh network where messages travel through all the network and you try to send it to everybody. But you can share it later on with the contacts. You know that that they are also in the forum. But yeah, Briar tries to protect metadata as best as possible and therefore gives you the choices when to share which data. And the last greatest feature or large feature of Briar are blogs, which is a little bit like Twitter or the Fediverse, for example. There you can post blog posts or something, and then those posts are shared with all your contacts. But those contacts don't share your blog post with their contacts unless they click that share button up there and retweet it. In a sense, so and then you can share those blog posts. But by this, you need to have active interaction by your contact so that blog posts spread in the Briar network. And the last feature that's also integrated in Briar is an RSS feed reader. So RSS is a protocol to subscribe to websites so that you get informed about new blog posts or articles. And those RSS feeds integrate very nice into Briar, and all those entries get shown in your blog section, and then you can share them. And then by this, your contacts can also see what RSS news you are getting. If you want to know more about Briar's features, we have here a user manual that you can look up. There you see that index number one. I will show some slides at the end where you find all the references for this talk. But for the moment, let's shortly revise the different network types that exist. And for once, there's the centralized approach. That's the most popular one today. And in a centralized network, you have only a single server in the center. And for example, if those little dots there are the people communicating with each other, they all have to send their messages first to the centralized server, and there it gets redistributed. This is like Signal and WhatsApp and Facebook and basically all the popular messenger that you know, they are using this approach. But of course, the problem is clear here. like we realized some weeks ago, when this single server goes down, then all the communication globally is shut down, and nobody can communicate. And also, another problem in the context of Briar is that you can easily block centralized servers, because there's only like some IP addresses that you need to block, and this gets better in a federated network, like for example XMPP, where you can have multiple servers to communicate with, and then all the contacts have a server that they are sending the messages to, but you don't need to use that server. You can go to another server and use it. This already improves the situation a lot. You still need someone experienced to run that server, and you can still like rather easily block a federated, or at least the parts of a federated network, because you only need to identify one large server, and then you can block that server, and later on people have to search for a new server. And now there are also peer-to-peer networks, and in a peer-to-peer network everybody is potentially connected to everybody else. So there are no servers. You don't need any servers to communicate, and Briar is one of these peer-to-peer networks. They have their own problems, like for example, you need to be always online in Briar to send and receive messages. So when you go offline, there's no message synchronization. This is a lot better with the former approaches of centralized and federated networks, but we are working on this. So yeah. Now I want to talk a little bit about the type of mesh Briar is using, because like I already said, Briar isn't sending or isn't sharing your messages or your data with everybody who's using Briar, nor with all your contacts. Instead, it's using a single hop social mesh. So for each message, you determine a recipient, like for example Bob, and then you only send that message to Bob. If you have a forum and you shared it with a subset of your contacts, then you send all the messages to that forum to all those contacts that you shared the forum with. And this is called a single hop social mesh. And this is really great for metadata protection, but of course it drastically decreases the connectivity. So, for example, if the internet is shut down and after a natural disaster or something, you might don't care that much about metadata protection, but instead want to have your messages going to their destination. And therefore, Briar is currently looking into other types of mesh. And two options we identified. The first one is a multi-hop social mesh. So where, for example, you would send all messages to all your contacts that you added. So it's still a social mesh. You're not communicating with everybody who has Briar installed, but instead you trust your contacts that they will not analyze your metadata. And then if you're a peer group of three people and you communicate in a private chat, you always send that messages to everybody so that it's ensured that the message reaches its destination. And then, of course, there's also the possibility of a public mesh, where you just try to send your data to anyone who has Briar installed. And we will look into this. There's some research planned and also funded by a human rights organization that we are currently cooperating with. But of course, Briar users might not want to use a public mesh or not a single hop social mesh, and therefore we are thinking about doing something like the Tor browser's security slider, where you can set very easily which type of protection you need. So if you go with the safest mode, basically nothing changes. Like at the moment, but if you say, okay, I can go a little bit more higher in my not so much protected level, you can use the safer mode where, for example, you would send all the messages to all your contacts. And then there's the standard mode where you would just use public mesh and send out your messages to everybody who wants. I also wrote about this exact problem with natural disasters in the blog post. It's called Confronting Briar with Disasters. And if you're interested, you can read that later on. I will put the link to it in the references there. Yes, so, but now let's start a little bit talking about Briar's architecture. Briar is using a heavily layered approach when it comes to its code. So not only the protocols that were invented for Briar are layered, but also the code is layered. And at the lowest level, we have the Bramble library. So Briar is the name for the application that's enabling messaging and blog posts and forums and all this stuff. But at the basis of all of this, there's the Bramble library that allows you to reuse all this technology that I will present to you in your project. And we start at the bottom where you can see the transports that I already mentioned. So you can communicate via the local network, via Bluetooth, or via Tor. That's currently implemented. But a feature that will soon be released also is that you can send messages via removable drives. So you can attach a USB stick to your own memory card. You can put this into your smartphone or maybe also into your desktop client. And then you can say, okay, load all the messages for Bob on this memory card. And then you can send this memory card through snail mail or however you want to get your messages to your contact. So this is really nice if the internet is shut down and the Bluetooth and Wi-Fi isn't an option for you. Then you can very soon, can fall back to removable drives and send your messages via this. And then we are currently also developing the mailbox. And the mailbox is basically like going a little step back to the federated network and trying to do stuff like XMPP. So we have then an application that is basically serving as a store and forward server. So if your contact isn't online, then you will upload your messages to your own mailbox or to your contact's mailbox. And this mailbox can be online all the time or can be online at different times. But once your contact comes online, they can look in their mailbox or in your mailbox if there are new messages for them. And I will talk about this later on a little bit too. And other features that the Bramble library is offering is doing all the message synchronization, the handling and of your peers, all the cryptography that Briar is using to ensure security properties like confidentiality and authenticity so that nobody can read the stuff and nobody can pretend to be your friend. Also, the database is handled by Bramble. And then on top of this, there is the Briar core code, where all the different features are implemented, but in a way that it is platform independent. So you can see at the top, there is the Briar box, where there currently is only the Android app available. But we are also working on a desktop program currently, which we expect to release next year. And we can reuse all the code from the Android application because everything is separated and layered clearly. And so we basically just have to call the right Java APIs because Briar is implemented all in Java. And then we can use all those messaging, forums, blogs, clients without having to re-implement them ourselves. Yes, and one thing to notice here also is that the transport encryption is decoupled from the data synchronization. So you can easily switch the cryptographic algorithms later on, but also all the semantics and the structures of messages are decoupled from the data synchronization. So you can basically send any data. What you want, you can send over Bramble. So it's we really try to do it as most generic as possible, so it can be reused in other projects. And what inspired Briar were protocols like UUCP, Usenet, and FidoNet that were once popular before the internet came to us. I personally didn't know those protocols, but some of you might have used them in the past. And yeah, the design goal for Briar was that it supports both low latency and high latency simplex and duplex links. So for example, we want to communicate via the internet or via Bluetooth, but we also want to do stuff like memory cards and send messages over any transport that you can imagine, just so that the messages reach your contact. And to support this, Briar has two different modes, an interactive mode and a batch mode. And in the interactive mode, you first offer all the messages you want to send to your contact, and then the contact replies like, oh yes, I need this message and this message and this message, and then you send it to them. But this only works with duplex links, so where you can send a message and get a reply, but with simplex links, you have to use the batch mode. And in batch mode, you just send out all the messages all the time, so that hopefully they will reach your recipient. And the thing here is that Briar is doing this retransmission intents with an exponential backoff, so that if you're sending out messages all the time, the bandwidth required isn't increasing all the time, linearly, but only logarithmically, so that we don't use all the bandwidth available, but try to stay cool here. And then we have the protocols that were invented for Briar, for the use of Briar. And they are called all Bramble protocol. And at the bottom of it all, we have the Bramble transport protocol. This is the protocol on the transport layer that's sending all the messages, all the data to your contacts, and is ensuring that it's using all the different transports so that your messages reach your contact. And then on top of this, we have the application layer. And I split this up in two different parts because we, for once, have the contact establishment when you first make contact with a friend, for example, and later on you communicate with them. And once you communicate with them, you're using the Bramble synchronization protocol. So this is working on detecting which messages are still to be sent, and it's telling Bramble protocol, the Bramble transport protocol, and please send those messages to this person and then to this person. This is the Bramble synchronization protocol that's doing this job. And then for making contact with your friends, there are two options currently. The first one was that you can scan and show QR codes. And I will talk about these QR codes later on, but those QR codes contain all the information necessary so that you can later on communicate with your friends, because at Briar we don't use identifiers like, for example, XMPP or email, because we neither use, for example, the DNS system. So here I will talk about this later on, but you basically have to remember where your contacts are reachable over which transport. So for example, we are storing the Bluetooth MAC ID of your contact, so that once you're close and you see, oh, that's a MAC ID I know, then you automatically connect to your contact and all the stuff this is the Bramble QR code protocol that's handling this. But some 2 years ago, I would say, we also added the option to make contact via Briar links. And about the Briar links, I will also talk later on. But here we are using two protocols. First, the Bramble rendezvous protocol, so that you can discover where your contact is in this peer-to-peer network. And then later on, once you have made the connection, we are using the Bramble handshake protocol. That's very simple, but I will talk about this later on. And now for a moment, I just wanted to give some basics about cryptography. There are two modes of encryption. For once, there is the symmetric encryption that's already known to humans for many, 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 many decades, years, year hundreds. And with symmetric encryption, you basically only have one key. And you can imagine, like, for example, the keys of a door, where you are using the same key to open the door, but also to later close the door. And that's really cool. At Briar, we are using this, and all the world is using symmetric encryption. But the problem is, how do we establish a shared key, this private key, because nobody else is allowed to know this, because if they know the key, then they can decrypt all your data, and that's, not cool. Therefore, thankfully, we have asymmetric encryption, where we have not only one key, but two keys, a public key and a private key. And if we go back to the door, you have one public key to close the door, and then only the person who has the private key can later on reopen the door. So if you want to encrypt something for somebody, you're using their public key, and only that person who has the private key can decrypt the message. And this is really cool, but the problem here is that it's very less performant than, for example, symmetric encryption. So what we need to do is, what would be really cool in terms of performance, is to start with asymmetric encryption and later on switch to symmetric encryption, because that's faster and also other things you can do better with this. And luckily, we have something like the Diffie-Hellman protocol, which I will talk, or which I will mention a lot in my upcoming slides, and therefore I want to only shortly explain it. The idea here is that you're publishing your public key, which in this case would be the brown or orange and blue colors, and then you send those public keys to your contacts, and then they are adding their secret colors. And after the Diffie-Hellman, their secret colors are basically their private keys. So you need your own private key and their public key, and then you can establish a shared common secret. And the thing here is that a third party can listen on this connection and read all the messages that you are communicating, but still they have no idea what your shared common secret is afterwards. And this, I personally find really amazing that this is possible. And all the internet, Briar is using Diffie-Hellman all the time to create their private symmetric keys. But let's start meeting up with the Briar QR code protocol. So, like I already said, this is one option for making contact via Briar. And what basically happens here is that you show a QR code on your device and also scan the QR code of your friend at the same time. And those QR codes contains two things, basically: a commitment to your public key and transfer properties. So in the case of the QR codes, the Bluetooth MAC ID and your local IP address and the port, so that you scan the QR code and then you can try to make a connection to that Bluetooth or local network device. And the commitment to the public key is basically like the fingerprint, so a hash of the public key, because public keys can be quite long and the commitment is much shorter, and so the QR codes aren't like really large. But you need screens and cameras to do this, and also a short range bi-directional transport. So if you want to communicate with somebody who is living in another town and you can't meet up, then you can't use the Bramble QR code protocol to make a connection to them. But once we have exchanged the public keys via this bi-directional transport, like for example Bluetooth, you scan the QR code, and then the first thing you do is to connect via Bluetooth and exchange the whole public key in total. And you compare this, is this the right public key to a commitment? And then what both parties are basically doing is Diffie-Hellman. So they both agree on a shared secret, which can then later on be used for the Bramble transport protocol and all the logic that Briar is doing. But like I said, if you aren't in the same town, you might want to use something different, and therefore we can do some rendezvous and use the Bramble rendezvous protocol. And here you are using Briar links instead of QR codes. And instead of using Wi-Fi or Bluetooth, here we are using the Tor network to make our first connection. And one has to watch out, because those Briar links don't directly translate to Tor.onion links, but instead we are doing something different. But to shortly revise the Tor network, to those who don't know, the Tor network is a network that tries to anonymize your communication so that your internet service provider doesn't know with whom you're communicating. It does this by always relay your data via three Tor relays. And you can also spin up a server only in the Tor network. And then both sides will basically do this Tor algorithm. So in total, you have six hops in the Tor network. And you don't use the normal DNS system that's already known from the internet for communication or for finding the right server in the Tor network. But instead, you're using those .onion links that are that basically contain or are the fingerprints of your public key. And then it's using something called DHT, I think, distributed hash table, so that all people find their destination in the Tor network. So what we need to do in order to find each other in the Tor network when we are making contact at Briar is creating Tor hidden services that both parties know. So it's a discovery protocol for peer networks, and those Briar links are only based on public links. There, another time, there's only the commitment or the fingerprint in the Briar link. But you don't need to directly publish the network addresses, like for example the onion address in this Briar link. But instead, it's generating each time when you connect to somebody some pseudo-random contact details. And we could use any transport that's that allows us to connect via public keys and distributed hash table mechanism, but currently we are using only the Tor hidden services. So in future we might also support other transport protocols, but yeah, for the moment it's only Tor. And now what we are doing is we are another time are doing Diffie-Hellman with the public keys that we have in the Briar links. And then we derive a shared secret from those public links so that both parties have the same shared secret. And then one party is using the first half and the other party is using the second half of this private key as a seed to generate a new public key for the Tor network. And by this, both sides can do this. And then Alice, for example, is showing up somewhere in the Tor network, and Bob is showing up at another place in the Tor network. But both know exactly where they show up, because the seeds are known to both parties. And yeah, if you want to read about it later on, it's number 12 in the references. There I linked the protocol specification for later on reading. But now we have made a connection via the Tor network that's still insecure. Like we don't want to reuse this private key we used for making contact in the Tor network for our later Bramble and Briar purposes. So after making connection via Tor, we are using the Bramble handshake protocol to use this connection to establish an ephemeral shared key, because Briar is also doing forward secrecy over all those transports that I just mentioned. So even via removable drivers, we are doing forward secrecy. And therefore, it's important to use an ephemeral shared key that can later on be deleted, so that you can't regenerate and decrypt all the data. I will talk about forward secrecy later on. But so now we have a connection via Tor. We have public key. So what we will now do is Diffie-Hellman another time to establish this ephemeral shared key. And that's basically all of this. It's like, I think BHP, the Bramble handshake protocol, is the simplest one at Briar. And you can look up number 13 for this. But now we are starting to do some logistics, and we will use the Bramble transport protocol. So this is the protocol that is handling all the communication and looking that your data is flowing through all the transports via the network. Yeah. And what the Bramble transport protocol is providing is a secure channel with confidentiality, integrity, authenticity, and forward secrecy. So we don't want anyone else to read our messages. We want to make sure that they weren't modified after our contact sent to them. We want to make sure that it's a message by our contact, so that it's an authenticated message. And we also want to do forward secrecy, because you can delete messages in your Briar application, and you can even configure your private chat so that messages get deleted automatically. And if now an eavesdropper or an attacker is listening on your device's traffic all the time, they could lock all the and save all the encrypted data that you send, and then later on break into your device to decrypt the encrypted data that they have previously captured. And to prevent doing this, we are also supporting forward secrecy. So once you deleted messages on your local device and your contact also deleted that message and the rotation periods also passed, then you can be made sure that nobody can decrypt the data that somebody might have collected, because the keys no more exist, and neither can you regenerate those keys. Yes. And we do all of this over a wide range of underlying transport. So Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, memory cards, whatever you mentioned, you can implement any transport that you're interested in. And Briar, the Bramble Transport Protocol, also don't has any timeouts, handshakes, or plain text headers. So if somebody is listening on your traffic, on your device's traffic, they can't really say that you're using Briar. So this is also a design goal of Briar, that it's hard to find out that you're actually using Briar. So all the data leaving your device is basically looking like random. There's no plain text like saying, OK, I'm Briar. Or for example, with HTTP, where the domain, I think, is left in plain text. And so you can identify HTTP traffic. And we want to support this so that Briar is usable with traffic analysis prevention techniques. So something like deep package inspection, DPI, where people could monitor, okay, who's using Briar in this network. We don't want this to happen. But some things that Briar isn't supporting are anonymity, unlinkability, and unobservability. If you want to have this, and Briar users want to have this, those features, the Bramble Transport Protocol uses Tor, because Tor gives us all those properties, and yeah, you don't directly have them in BTP. So, what I already said, even if you have transports like removable drivers, the BTP is giving you forward secrecy. And because normally, I think Omemo and the signal protocol, and there you have to make contact at a regular basis to rotate the encryption keys. But we are using a time-based key management protocol, so that even if you don't have any contact with your peer, because you're, for example, using a simplex connection, you can still rotate the key and have all those features of forward secrecy. And for this time-based key management protocol, what we basically do is dividing time into numbered periods. And those periods have a length of d plus l seconds, where d is the maximum expected time difference between devices. Because when we developed Briar, we noticed that some consumer devices sometimes have an offset of up to 1 day in their time. And if two people try to communicate with this offset and with this time-based key management protocol, yeah, things wouldn't work. So we have to respect and take into consideration this time difference. And then we have also L, and L is dependent on the transport. So it's the maximum expected latency we have. And for the Tor internet, for example, it's just some seconds. But for those removable drivers, I think we agreed on using 28 days as a latency. So during this 28 days, you won't rotate any keys, so that you can still decrypt data if it reaches you 1 month afterwards, or even 2 months afterwards, because Briar is storing the last, the current, and the next period's keys. So if there's a little offset in the time, you can still decrypt and encrypt all the data. And the wire protocol, to talk a little bit about this, is split up into three parts. We first have a pseudo-random tag, because you have to imagine that you're getting data from a lot of people via Briar, and it's all looking like random. You don't have any plain text headers, nothing which would allow you to say, okay, is this just somebody annoying me with random data, or which key do I have to use? And therefore, Briar is using this pseudo-random tag that both sides have. And then once a stream reaches you, a stream of data, you first look up that first couple of bytes to see, okay, this is a message by my friend Bob, who's sending me a message via the Tor network, and I have to decrypt it using this key we both generated. And then after this tag, there comes a stream header where we put an ephemeral cipher key. And so each messages or each message is encrypted with a different key. And afterwards, they can follow one or more frames where the actual data is encrypted with the cipher key from your stream header. So you can happily decrypt your messages. And those are the cryptographic algorithms Briar is using. For once, we have the stream cipher XSalsa 20 and the message authentication code Poly 1305. And Plague2B for the hash and MAC. We are using ED25519 for signatures, which is using the cryptographic curve that we also use for key agreement, just in case you're interested. But like I already said, this is not set in stone, and we took care that later versions of Briar can easily switch all those cryptographic algorithms, so that when, for example, one algorithm has some weakness and we should no more use this, we can easily switch the cryptographic algorithms. And only to come to an end, I will shortly talk about the the Bramble synchronization protocol. So this is the protocol that is organizing the data so that you know, okay, which messages do I have to send to which contact. This is done on the application layer by BSP. And to only talk a little bit about the terminology we are using at BSP, each device that has Briar installed can have a set of peers. So those are your contacts. And then those devices or those Briar instances can be part of groups. And those groups contain a message graph. So all the messages, like for example in the forum, they are stored in the graph. And then those messages can be shared or also deleted. And if you delete a message from your message graph, you basically replace it with another text saying, OK, I deleted this message. But so that if a contact is trying to offer you this message another time, you can say, no, I already received it, but I'm no longer interested in it. And each group belongs to a Briar client. So if you remember the architecture diagram that I'd shown to you, there are clients, BSP clients for the forums, for private messaging, for blogs. And if you want to use the Bramble protocol for your own purposes, you would start by developing your own client. So one thing that the Briar developers had on their mind when they started with Briar is that all this technology could also be used for purposes like crisis mapping with OpenStreetMap, where you have no internet. And so you try to map the area using this peer-to-peer network, or also things like collaborative document editing. But basically, like I have shown you, Briar and Bramble are very generic, and you can use them for any purposes. And to end this, I only shortly want to talk about the open problems we still have, but also some upcoming solutions we have at Briar. For the moment, there's a need to be always online. So if you're offline, there's no device sending or receiving your messages. So you basically can't use Briar if you don't if you aren't online. But that would be okay because our smartphones are running all the time, and so they could be connected to the Briar network constantly. We are using the Tor network, and the Tor network has to do some rotation mechanism all the time, and therefore Briar is currently consuming a lot of battery. And therefore, a lot of people aren't using Briar at the moment because it's very power consuming. And if you turn this off, you are no longer online and don't receive messages. Then Briar is only available on Android so far. And like I said, it's all implemented in Java. And we are currently working on a desktop client, but for now, there's only Android. And we only support low-quality images in private chat for the moment. Because in the Bramble transport protocol, messages can have a maximum size of 32 kilobytes. And we currently don't have a mechanism to connect different messages to each other. So for the moment, you can only send those compressed images that are compressed down to 32 kilobytes. But of course, in the future, we want to support higher quality attachments and also other attachments, like, for example, voice messages. And there are also a lot of more fundamental problems that we have no idea about, because Briar is doing a lot of trade-offs, like, for example, a trade-off between privacy and connectivity, or a trade-off between privacy and efficiency. And you can look them up in number 16 there. And the solutions that I already mentioned is this mailbox. And where the mailbox is basically an application that you install on some old device. Then you scan QR codes with your main prior application. And then you can put this mailbox to your power connection and leave it in at your local Wi-Fi, like I did with my other device back there. And because later on we can try Briar if you want to, and to have at least one device online all the time, I now put my second smartphone there. But in future, you can use something like the mailbox, and then the mailbox will store and forward all your messages. So this is basically the diagram that shows that if Alice is offline, Bob can send messages to her, and then instead of sending waiting and doing nothing, Bob sends a message to Alice's mailbox. And once she comes online, she can receive her messages. Then, like I said, in the future, we will also support removable drives so that you can send your memory card via BERT if you want to, and your Briar messages. And a really cool feature that will also land in Briar soon is that we will allow Briar to be shared offline. So if the internet is shut down and only one person has Briar installed, they can communicate with the other people because they can't download the Briar application. Like, you, of course, you can exchange the APKs and all that stuff, but we have implemented a feature so that you can say in the Briar application, okay, please share my application, my Briar application, with my contacts, so that they can also participate with Briar. And you no longer need internet to install and get Briar. And then there's also the desktop program, which I'm currently working on. This is a current screenshot, and for sure it will change in the future, where you basically can use all the features that you know from Briar Android on your desktop device. And to only shortly comment it, we are using Kotlin and a UI framework called Compose for Desktop, which is basically a part of the Chatpack Compose framework that's already known from the Android world. And we are using it on the desktop because we want to make use of Briar's Java API. And we decided that this is the best framework and it has the most promising future. Therefore, we wanted to use this. And we want to support Windows, macOS, and Linux. And in future, we might also share the UI components with Android, because this is a really cool thing that you already know from React and other frameworks that you can only, that you only have to develop your UI code once, and then it works on Android and desktop, and they are also planning it to do an iOS. If we ever do an iOS client, we surely want to, but if you are using Compose there, it's still open, but at least there is a possibility. And with this work, we are currently supported by the Prototype Fund, which is sponsored by the Federal Ministry of Education and Research. And we are three developers here, but those screenshots that you just saw, is based on a third-party developer from Briar's Communicate, from Briar's community, and I want to use this possibility to thank him, Paul. Thanks a lot. Because at Briar it's really cool. We have a very engaged community, and yeah, there are awesome people. And I want to thank everybody at Briar for their awesome work. And also, I want to thank you for listening. Like I promised, I put references to everything I said here on those slides, with all those numbers. And if you want to look at the presentation another time, you can go to my website and swipe through the slides another time. Yeah, so thanks a lot.
Nico, great talk, very interesting. Now we have time for questions. I have a few questions from the internet, and you can ask questions. I'm happy to pass you just a microphone if you want to ask questions, or if you want to be in the spotlight, you're happy to join us here on the stage to ask a question. So I start with one from the internet, yeah. So people can think about it and queue up. The one from the internet is, has anyone looked into post-quantum Bramble, and is this a priority in the project over the next near-term future?
Sorry. Yeah. If I remember, the people at Briar, or the people working on the lower components of Briar said that this post-quantum future isn't a problem with once we are communicating, but at the moment it's not secure for or in with quantum computers. So that's definitely a thing we want to look into currently. But I don't know that anybody is working on this currently. But of course, when quantum computer exist, and they would break Briar's encryption, we would need to come up with something different. So, yeah.
Okay, then.
Maybe? Yes. You mentioned the mailbox thing. I was wondering, because I think in general it would be interesting to explore solutions where you go peer-to-peer where possible, but rely on servers when necessary. Mm-hmm. And somehow it's, I kind of feel like nobody's doing that, because either we're doing XMPP where we're exchanging messages in situations where this server would not be needed, where we just could go peer-to-peer. Mm-hmm. And on the other hand, we have the peer-to-peer solutions like Briar, where I feel like they would have better UX if they would use the server when necessary. Yes. So the mailbox thing seems to go a little bit in that direction. But if I got you right, the idea is just for the mailbox to be a solution that I, the Briar user, must maintain myself. So I would set up the, I'm not sure what exactly it is. It is a piece of software,
yes,
for forwarding that could run on a device or on my Raspberry Pi or whatever, but probably still not something that a normal end user would be capable. So my question is there anyone interested in providing a more traditional server?
Mm-hmm.
Turning the mailbox into something that multiple users could use and that could be maintained in a by a separate party, or would that go too much against the Briar spirit?
Yeah. So in contrast to XMPP, for example, this Briar mailbox is completely optional, so you don't have to use it, but you can use it as. And the idea is that we at least want to try it, that people can just install the Briar mailbox application. So this will be an Android application that you can install on your old Android device. And then you just have to send scan QR codes with this mailbox. And this is basically all you need to set up this mailbox. So it's really easy. But still, this will be implemented in Java, I think. And we also plan to later on release packages so that you can install it on your server, for example, on your VPS or something. And we also thought about supporting multiple users in the mailbox. So like an XMPP server, there's one device that is storing and forwarding all the messages of all those users that are connected to it. But this is something new, and we want to try it out to make it really easy to set up the Briar mailbox so that there don't happen things like, this is the first Briar mailbox in the network. Let's go all to this Briar mailbox. Like, for example, with jabber.ccc.de, I think, or mastodon.social. Those are very large instances, and where all this idea of metadata protection is basically, you can watch all the metadata flowing through there. So we want to try it at the moment, but of course somebody could create a script to set up various Briar mailboxes on their server, because we make this all generic and abstracted. And maybe in future we have to say and have to admit, okay, not everybody wants to set up their own Briar mailbox, so we also support that you can add your friends, for example, and introduce them to your mailbox or something like this. But for the moment, we want to try it this way.
Thanks. Yes.
Okay, think about more questions. I have one more. Question to the always on problem. Why isn't there a feature to switch Briar on a regular based on UTC? For example, 00 or 12. Yes. It could be more often like 00, 6, 12, 18, 24, or additionally 03, 9, 15, 21, and so on.
Yes. If I remember correctly, there were two problems and why we didn't want to do this. For once, we don't want to let anybody know that we are using Briar. And if suddenly all devices that have Briar installed would come on online at the same time, you would easily know, okay, this Tor server is a Briar instance. And then you would know there's Briar. You could also do something different, that not all devices are going online at the same time, but then you have the problem that you have somehow do this so that you and your contacts are online at the same time. And there are more problems still to this, and therefore we want to go with the Briar mailbox approach before doing something like this, like coming on regularly. But what I am personally doing is, for at least at the moment, until the Briar mailbox is available, there's an option in the Briar Android application that says only use the internet, the Tor transport, when charging. So each time I charge my device, my Briar application is coming online. And then if it happens that my contacts are online at the same time, because they're also charging their devices, in the evening, and we could exchange those messages, but of course that's not giving me a lot more connectivity than I already have at the moment. Yes, but that's one tip.
Trying not to be mean, but I think like if you use Briar, you spend a lot of time charging your phone. Actually, yes. No more questions. I have another one: BTP over Mixnet. Any plans? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there are no plans for this. Since the beginning, there is an issue, I think, for using I2P, another anonymization network like Tor. But like I said, you can implement any transport. And if you want, you can for sure develop a transport for Nixnet. And we at Briar will happily work together with you so that this is supported. In the code, in the client. Yeah. So we are open to new transports. It's just we need somebody to work on this, because we are like 5 developers, I think, doing work voluntarily and sometimes paid, and there are a lot of things to do, but nobody available to do this. Like, this already a common problem in free software, but we also have it.
Cool, thanks. Any more questions from the chat? Or there's something from the chat. Oh yeah, that's a meta question. Okay, then I would say thanks a lot, Nico. We will have more conversations here, but I guess not on the stream, so we can follow up with that. Thanks.
Thanks a lot for inviting me here.
It was great to have you, really.
Yes. Thanks.